I'm courageous, I'm brave, but I'm weak, you know? So that's not a good combination, because I would go to fight, and then I'm gonna get beaten.
I saw your bride is here, I think.
She
can go kick anybody's butt, I think.
She's the brave one. Yeah.
And pretty tough.
Yeah, she's tough. She's tough. And then the baby inside her.
She's got a baby in there too?
No. We're waiting. Our second daughter.
It's a sequel.
That's right. The second part.
So the whole second movie, Wild Tales 2, will be giving birth?
Women. I have one girl. Uh-huh. Her name is Rose, and we're waiting another one.
So where did this particular movie start? Was this a moment of inspiration, or?
Yeah, I was writing other stories, a huge science fiction tale in which I was involved for years, and I couldn't finish it, and I still didn't finish it. and then some new ideas became to appear. And I tried to reduce them to their minimum expression, mm-hmm. compress those stories. And what I got were tales, short tales, with extreme power, very powerful tales. Mm-hmm. And you know, I wrote one, I wrote another, and sin darme cuenta.
And without even realizing it.
I found out that I had a new movie already written, a new project.
So is your science fiction movie funny?
It has humor. I wouldn't say it's a comedy. It's an epic tale. Definitely it has humor. Yes.
So did you start as a funny person? Was that your...
No, like in front of the cameras or
were you a class clown?
Yeah, I think I can make some good jokes, but I also like action films and westerns. And I had a western in English, which I'm making a few years next year. I love comedy, of course, not only comedy.
So this
all
is
all genres as well.
So this film shouldn't define you as a director?
No. I think it does. I think it does. It has a mixture between genre films and real life situations. You know, since I am a kid, my father is a truly movie lover and a movie goer. I mean, a middle class movie goer. And he takes me to the movies since I was born. Almost my first memory of the life is a screen with a movie in it with Superman, Richard Donner's Superman.
Wow!
So that's how I began existing, you know. And then the westerns. And
how old were you when that
first came? 3 years old.
So you remember part?
No, the Superman part, the part in which Superman takes Lois Lane for a flight. Yeah, that kept inside me. And then another part with a woman. Superman is in a pool, in Lex Luthor's pool, down in the Grand Central Station, kind of refuge.
Yeah.
And then he has kryptonite in his neck, and Lex Luthor's assistant takes the kryptonite, but before taking it, she gives him a kiss.
Right.
And then Superman defends the door and goes flat and breaks the ceiling. And that image also. Those are my first two memories. But then again, my father loved Super 8 filming, and he used to buy a lot of cameras. And he used to shoot our family during vacation or during everyday activities. And then he used to put music from the films he loved to family movies, to home movies. So I used to see me riding on a horse with Ennio Morricone's score of Sergio Leone's film, and then I used to see my mother in the beach with Gone with the Wind theme, Tara's theme, during the sunset. So movies and family and real life situations are truly mixed in my memories, and I think I see life through movies.
Do you ever have any question about whether being a professional was a good idea, or was that always just a given you were going to end up in this business?
No. I think I discovered that with a cousin of mine that someday he told me that with the camera he had in the that some friend of him, this with a camera in his home, he made a fiction film. I was like 9, 10. And I found out, wow, of course, I have a camera in my house. I have a lot of cameras, actually. So I can shoot fiction. That's a wonderful idea. It came to me as a revelation. And that summer, I did some movies, some Hitchcock, I wouldn't say parodies. I tried to do it seriously, you know, and provoke tension and fear. But I remember my grandmother laughing a lot, you know, when the killer with a POV of the murderer walking through the hall of my house, and my grandmother laughing a lot, and I would say, hey, this is serious. I'm trying to make a horror movie. But that's where the idea of becoming a director began. Like, I used to have my father then bought the camera, the same one that Marty McFly uses in Back to the Future, the first one, JVC camera, Bordeaux, the Bordeaux one. I had the same camera. I began to film shorts, first with my family, then I started in high school. We have a media specialization
in
the apartment. So I learned to edit. And
how did you edit? I mean, what were you editing on when you were that little?
With two VCRs.
Next to each other.
Yeah. First of all, I used to edit on camera, and if the shot wasn't good, I would rewind it and then do it again and learn all the tricks to don't have those filthy frames in the middle, you know. So you have like continuity. Yeah, first of all, I edited on camera. Then I learned to edit with two VHS, two VCRs. And then in high school, I found out that there was like a professional VHS editing site, and I learned how to use it. And from then on, well, the Avid. But I never edited on Moviola. My father did. I used to watch him to cut the Super 8 films and
hard to cut Super 8 films.
Yeah.
The soundtrack on Super 8 films is very difficult.
Very difficult.
I did that. That's how old I am. I'm about 10 years older than you, I think.
Yeah.
And I tried it on Super 8 and it was brutal.
Yeah. He did it very well. I have a great, he was a great director. He didn't know that. He passed away and missed him so much. But he was a great director. Very passionate, you know. And he used to make like those violent zooms a la Morricone, but without a la Sergio Leone, but without knowing it. I think he was truly a passion guy, you know. Mm-hmm. To my sisters, and my mother. A great movie.
So, do you see yourself as a writer first or as a director first?
It started all together during the first short films. I think, for a long time, I didn't separate the writing from directing. And I made two television series. So I think I got used to write one episode while directing another and while editing something that I shot before. And in my previous films and TV series, I mean, that was the procedure, the natural procedure. But then with this film, and before this film happened, I decided to just write for a long time, and I developed a few projects, and then direct, not writing while I'm not writing, and give the direction. And I think this film, in my story, I see a visual improvement, you know, in the conception of the shots and the storytelling, I did a lot of work before going to the shooting, and I didn't do that job in the previous films. You know, I mean, of course, I saw location, I could feel, but I was more into an intuition guy, intuition. Yeah. So I followed the camera, and now I was a lot more conscious about the language and yeah, how to tell the story.
And collaborators also, more collaborators?
Yes, I had a great cinematographer. The ones that I worked before, they're great too. But yeah, I admire Javier Julia, which is a great photographer. And we talk a lot. And yes, I had a lot of collaboration. And the producers were I had great producers in this film. I mean, it's fun to say, you know, the producers only want you to shoot quickly, and they're against the art and all that kind of stuff. But the people I had in this project, they did a lot of efforts to let me be free and to ensanchar,
to
enlarge the world in which we were working.
But I assume you already shoot quickly. You're a TV guy.
No, I'm not. I don't shoot. I shoot a lot of takes.
What are you looking for when you shoot a lot of takes?
The acting, the perfection. I think I'm, yeah.
So you know what you really want.
I mean, when I think that something can be better, I mean, I forget about everything else. This won't sound good. To people from the industry hearing that, but I mean when I think something can improve, no, it's like I want that, I want the better stuff, and then we go on again. But I mean we made this film on time, and I wouldn't say on budget, but almost on budget, just a few days.
Yeah. So you drive your actors crazy, or are they just used to it and they like it?
No, I think, I mean, in Argentina, we don't have that much tradition in great scripts. I wouldn't say we have, you know, like great scripts. So the actors are very used to improvise, and they learn that in TV, where the script is only like a guide, and then they read it, they understand the scene, and then they make the scene there. And they're very used to not follow a screenplay, you know. But these actors are all amazingly talented, and they are classic actors, very formed people, and they trust very much in me as a director and in the script they read. So all the energy and all the work.
Was directed to
give life and vitality to the already written part, like the way you, I think, were.
So you precious?
But that's not the usual thing in Argentina.
So are you precious about your words, or are you?
I like to write. I mean, when I write, I improvise. You know, I'm lying there on the floor or on the couch and walking, and then I have this
recorder.
Yeah, this recorder. So I did, and I think I know the dialogues are alive, and I know that, and I trust them because I live with the script a lot of time before shooting, and then I hear the music. I know what I want to make,
right?
And so I make that. But I need, of course, the talent of the actors to see those ideas live again. You know, when you see the idea, you're the first spectator. You're the first of the film. You know, I see the film. I try to see what my subconscious brings, and I try to see it, and then take notes of what I see there. It's like in a dream. I mean, you go to sleep, and appears in front of you, inside of you, scenarios, characters, conflict situations, And you lead them as if they were created by somebody else, and it's yourself that it's creating. Or I don't know, that's science fiction stuff in which I'm watching the other
movie. Whole other movie. Yeah.
And then somebody creates that. I don't know. I mean, we have an amazing head. We have an amazing head. You know, I always think, I mean, I see you, and perhaps tonight I'll dream with you. And okay, don't worry. No, it won't be a sexual dream.
I know, but I could be dead. Give it a movie.
Yeah, you can be dead. But I mean, my mind is going to recreate the whole of you, and I can make you walk and jump, and to do that in real life, you need machines, very hard machines, and lots of people rendering and drawing, and so your mind is it's a FX factory, an amazing FX. So something is there inside. I don't know. During writing, I try to see the movie and intervene as less as possible. Mm-hmm. Okay, the conflict appear. Okay, that's what I'm doing. I'll take note, or I would make a sketch. And then, what does this guy do? And I close my eyes and try to follow him. Okay, wow. See, yes, that's the thing. And that's how I write. So then when I go to the shooting, I like to recreate that because I like the movie I saw.
So is there anything in this movie that came out better than you remembered it?
All of it. The movie I see is much better than the one that I imagined. Yes. Oh. Yes, because of the work of the cinematographer, the actors, especially, and the crew. We have the guy, the key grip guy we have, and he's a genius. I mean, I think he's an artist. The movie, in some point, is its form. You know, and these guys makes the form of the movie. He makes this strange dolly for the plane, for the shot of the plane, very very small dolly, and he invents like platforms to let us be standing in the middle of the mountain in which the cars are. I wouldn't have made this movie without him. He's very very creative and passionate person. And movies are made by those people.
So you were expecting the response you got here at Cannes, right?
Oh, well, no. I would say I'm thrilled and I'm amazed. I mean, when you do a movie, it can work or it can't. And there are a lot of examples of movies that didn't work. And the guys that did the movies didn't know that they were not going to work. So you're always afraid. And actually, the first screening of the film was with specialized press from all over the world, hard critics, you know. So I was terrified. And when I heard that there were laughs and applauses during the projection, I was like, critics like this kind of movie. I think the movie can establish a relationship with the viewer and be successful. Exposing its ideas, and so we went last night to the red carpet and to the official screening. That's the first time I saw the film with an audience, and everything worked fantastic.
So just exactly as you saw it?
Just better than I saw
it. The laughter was where you expected it and all the...
Ah, no, it was louder. they would laugh in parts that it reminded me to my grandmother laughing during the action season. But when the guys are fighting inside the car, people were laughing. I mean, I know there's humor in that situation. But I wouldn't think that because of the violence... I mean, the violence and the humor...
Get together well.
I think it's for me an accomplished task.
And you're a veteran filmmaker already. Does this feel like a coming out? Do you feel like, because it's to the world, this is, you're new?
Yes, I am new. Yes. Yeah, I mean, I made, in Argentina, I made a TV series which is called Los Simuladores, The Pretenders. It was a success. I mean, critical, and they used to give it. I mean, once and again and again and again and again all the time, like 11 times on prime time, and it's still, the numbers were still good. And then the format, the was bought by Sony, and they made remakes in Mexico, Russia, and several countries. But the films I made, and I think those TV series, I made the original ones, not the remake.
Right.
Were popular in Argentina, but not in other countries, so not that much as Argentina. And yes, I think I feel like a new director now, because I have a new audience and a very intelligent one, exigente.
Very, it's asking a lot for me.
Intelligent public and screening the movie next to other huge movies and directors. I was walking down the hotel door, and then David Cronenberg said, hi, and they introduced, oh yeah, I heard it was good. I was 7, 8, 9 when I saw The Fly, and I remember those images and that story and the way it was just tell. Okay, people that I admire. So yes, it feels like a new, etapa,
a new
stage,
phase in my life.
New phase in my life. Yeah. So it feels like something. It's good for us.
And David Cronenberg's known for his comedy, so.
Yes.
He's a funny guy.
Yeah, he is. I see the humor in the ear from the Jeff Goldblum ear. You know, falling. I think the guy has to laugh when he mentions it.